Thank you very much for coming. Welcome to Two for Tonight at L'Auberge Chez François. I'm Jacques Haeringer. Today we are celebrating a birthday surprise, and make it a real surprise for that special someone. Do a little prep work ahead, bring them right here in the kitchen, and do as we do in the back, just do the little final cooking and finishing touches right before their eyes. Strut that culinary stuff. Right. And who knows what'll happen after that. Today we are doing a tartare of Arctic char, one of my favorites. We're gonna do a local rockfish in vermouth sauce, and we're gonna do an exotic fruit salad. You know, I am often asked what the proper attire is for the chef when he's preparing a romantic dinner. And of course, wearing only an apron comes to mind right away. However, even though we do not live in a subtle age, we don't want to be too forward in case perhaps it's the first date. So I also recommend perhaps a pair of hot chili pepper boxer shorts. You know, it might be appropriate. It's a little more modest, don't you think? All right, let's do our first recipe, which is, again, a tartare of Arctic char. Arctic char is a fish that comes from Iceland. You can either get it, if you're lucky, you can get it wild, or you can get it farm-raised. There are a few farms, actually, here in the United States, in Maine, for instance. And if you can get the wild, go for it. Sometimes it's a little bit larger fish. The one reason I like the Arctic char as opposed to the salmon, and it's a very similar fish to the salmon, very similar taste, utilized the same way, is the Arctic char tend to be a little smaller. You can sometimes find a very small one. And that's perfect because, after all, we are doing recipes for two. So, and the wild ones, again, the theory about having a wild fish is that they're actually swimming about and eating the right things for them, getting the proper nutrients, which they're going to pass on to us. There are wonderful aquaculture products, but they are given a feed, and one wonders if they're always getting the proper nutrients to pass on to us, because we want as much of the proper nutrients as we can get for good health and good loving. All right. Let me see if we can't show you how to fillet this thing here right now. I'd like to take a nice, sharp, clean knife here, cut just behind the head here, and then the plan is to run the blade of the knife against the backbone all the way down to get a proper fillet. Let's try to do that here. You know, we're the only species on the planet that eats cooked food. You know, I'll probably be drummed out of all the chefs' associations for saying it, but a certain amount of raw food in the diet is good for you, because when you cook foods over 112 degrees, you deactivate a lot of the important metabolic enzymes, which we need for all our functions, all our metabolic functions. So taking some in puts less stress on the body, and it gives you all those nutrients unfettered, uncooked. So you need a very good source of the fish, obviously, and a very clean cutting board and a clean knife. All right, let's see. Did everyone see that, I hope? Now, we're going to clean it up just a little bit here, remove a couple of the bones that are here. And you can use all the meat here for the tartare. You know, cooking is like love. It's a little messy sometimes, but here we go. Now, to skin the fish, hold the tail right down the thin part there. And again, same principle. We're going to run the knife flat on the surface against the skin and hopefully not cut through, and just do a nice clean. And if it's a little hard to grasp, you can always take a towel and hold the skin that way. Let's see if we can do this. Right there. You need about 6 ounces to make this recipe. I'm going to do a large dice. I don't like a tartare which is too small. I like a little texture. That's why it's difficult to put it in a food processor, because it tends to tear it up. So just, it doesn't take very much time. Do a large dice, as we have here. and then dice it again the other way. I mean, it's a personal preference, but you don't want it, I don't think, too small. Now, you can make this ahead, but again, since it's raw fish, keep it refrigerated. Don't make it too far ahead. About a medium dice here. All right. Let me put that out of our way. And grab a bowl. Any questions so far? Don't be afraid to interrupt me. Not that I'll know the answer, but I'll try. Now, we're going to season this with about a teaspoon of extra virgin olive oil. Now, extra virgin, that always throws me. You know what I mean? Does that mean there are two of them? Or is that a virgin that's never been kissed? I mean, either you are or you aren't. I mean, it's just, you know, we have a little salt and pepper. Again, I prefer a little sea salt, pepper. We have our olive oil. And we have here some grated, about a half a teaspoon of grated lime rind, teaspoon or so of lime juice, about a tablespoon of chopped chives, and a pinch of cayenne pepper. We want this to be a little hot and spicy. Right there. Mix it up, and you have your tartare right there. Now I'm going to taste it to make sure the seasoning is correct. Right here. Oh, a little more cayenne, you know? Let's do this right. Now, la pièce de résistance. We're gonna take two martini glasses. Actually, if you serve a few of these beforehand, it might even get you in the mood a little bit better, but all right, we're gonna take two leaves of radicchio and put them in there. Dress those like so. All right, take a little bit of any kind of lettuce. I'm using mash, which is lamb's lettuce, but mesclum or some baby spinach would be just fine. Put it in the bottom just as a base here. There we go. And I'm going to put the prepared tartare right on top. Little color. Dial it up just a little bit. Here we go. That's about enough. All right. And we're going to take a couple of capers. Right here. We will take a lime wedge, which is more for decor than anything since you have plenty of lime in there already. We're going to take a couple of chive straws just to give it a little height. We can get this to work here. Okay. And la pièce de résistance, a little bit of golden Ocetra caviar. I mean, do you care about him or her or not? I mean, you know, show it. Right? A little bit here, not too much. And we are going to put it on two plates. I like to serve it with toasted country bread. Like so.
Do we need to be concerned with the eating raw fish?
Personally, I'm more concerned about nutrition than bugs, if you will. But you have to have a fresh source of fish. That's why I urge everyone when you buy fish, and I know it's not always practical, and that's one reason I suggested the char, that you buy whole fish. You can, you know, check the eyes and the gills, and you can make sure that it is a little bit more, that it is fresh. It's harder when you see a fillet, especially under glass and lights, et cetera, to make sure it's very, very fresh. You have to have a proper source. Go out and catch a fish. There you go. Look what I caught for you, honey. And if you prepare this and serve it and nothing happens, better rethink the whole idea. Thank you very much. Our second dish is a local rockfish in vermouth sauce. I know you thought, perhaps, that you only waved the bottle of vermouth over a martini pitcher, and that was the only use for it. But I think this is a very simple, you can do all of these at home. These are not complicated recipes. Yes, you do have to do a little prep and a little effort, but I really believe that all of these can be done at home. And plus, you can taste the vermouth and, you know, just have a good time with it. We are going to use a local rockfish, which is our local name, if you will, for striped bass. You could certainly use a sea bass also. Why don't you bring those fish right in here, Erica, please? We have the rockfish right here, our local striped bass right here, and we have a black bass. Very similar texture and perfectly suitable. Any white firm fish would be good. Sole would be great. Flounder is not quite as firm a fish, but it would work also. All right, thank you very much. I'm not going to go through that fish cutting again. way too messy. We're going to take our fillet of rockfish right here. Again, if you can, buy whole fish and use the bones to make nutritious stocks. Every culture on the planet, all major cultures on the planet, take fish and meat bones and make nutritious stocks with them. There's gelatin in the stocks, which aid digestion. There's a wealth of minerals and nutrients. And in fish stock, or fumet de poisson, as we say in France, is loaded with trace minerals and iodine, which you don't often find anymore in land-based foods. Besides the nutrition part, it is the basis for a delicious stocks and sauces. Anyway, the people who come into the restaurant ask for sauce on the side. I'm just not sure they're happy people. All right, a little bit of butter. Okay, if you want to use oil, go ahead.
Can you freeze the bones and save it to...
You certainly can. Or you can make the stock ahead of time and freeze it. It'll keep a few days. You could certainly make that part ahead of time. You could put it in the refrigerator for a few days or put it in smaller containers and freeze them if you're going to make a large amount of stock. All right. We're going to take a third of a cup of carrots, onions, and leeks. And I'm going to use half of that to make the stock and the other half to finish the fish with. So it's not that much prep time. Once the butter starts to melt a little bit, we're going to take about a teaspoon of shallots. And then we're going to take the vegetables, the onions, carrots, and leeks, put them in there, sweat them a bit, as we say in the cooking vernacular, and then put in our bones, which we've chopped up and rinsed very well. All right. All right. Once that is sweated for a couple of minutes, we're going to put about a cup of dry white wine. One of the difficult parts about being a chef is you have to taste all the ingredients that you put into a dish to make sure they are compatible, that the marriageability of the product goes with the entire dish. So I guess I'm going to have to, taste it. Now again, if you put it in a glass and taste it, you could be considered drinking. But if you put it in a bowl, even if it's a big bowl, that's tasting. Totally different thing. All right, so let's put... There you go. There we go. Even if you use a straw, it's okay. We're using a white Alsatian wine today from my father's part of the world. All right, let's assume that this is cooked for about 10 minutes. This is all you need for your fish stock. This over here. All right, now... We're going to take our fish stock. And of course, for a traditional fumet de poisson, you cook it maybe about 30 minutes. But this will work at home, and you get all the goodness of the fish. You're going to use the stock in the sauce, and you're going to cook the fish right in the sauce. So it's a simple, straightforward preparation. We're going to let's put this over here so everyone can see it. Strain that in there and gather up the fumet de poisson, the fish stock. And we're going to prepare the rockfish. All right, let's take that fillet again. There's my knife. And I'm going to cut, you need about 8 to 10 ounces for two people. I think that's plenty. And cut it into a fairly large julienne. like this. That's the way it cooks very fast. I mean, you want to bring that person in the kitchen, but you don't want them to fall asleep while you're doing this. But I think it's definitely the way to go here. All right, we're going to take our fish stock and put it in the pan and let it reduce. Let it go down to thicken the sauce, to concentrate the flavors, all right? We're going to take a little, you knew it was coming, heavy whipping cream, 40% butterfat. You know you want it. What's wrong with butterfat?
Nothing.
There, we're all, see, unanimity. We're in agreement here. It's not a problem. We're only going to use a quarter of a cup. I'm giving you a break. Just a quarter of a cup today. Let's assume that our sauce is to the proper thickness. We are going to take the remaining one half of the 1/3 cup. Did I get that right? All right. And put it in. This is going to give you a little crunch. You know, and your veggies are already in there. You don't have to do a lot of extra preparation. So let's put the carrots, and that looks like a little bit too much there. The leeks, put them all in there, and add the fish. Okay. A little salt and pepper. Right here. And this is going to take, we're going to do this in real time. This is going to take about 2 minutes. And you have your finished main course. Any questions so far on that? I'm just going to cover it. And you'll see in just one moment, we'll have a finished sauce. There's only one more thing we've got to do. We've got to add the vermouth. Because it's a vermouth sauce. So I want to take that off when it's cooked. You could put it in before you put the fish, but we can put it in afterwards. Either way. Same old problem. I mean, we opened the vermouth a few moments ago. Perhaps the flavor has changed over the course of time. So we better taste it again. Okay. Oh, yes. That is. The fish is ready. We're going to add a little bit of the vermouth. Right, a little cayenne pepper to go along with the seasoning right here. And I'm going to take some fresh dill. Let's turn this off. It is cooked enough. A little bit of fresh dill. That sauce could be reduced a little bit more, but it's not absolutely necessary. And if you didn't, you start going a little crazy and don't want the heavy whipping cream, you could certainly make a nice, it will taste delicious just the way it is. It won't be quite as smooth, but you could just use the broth as the sauce. It will work perfectly. Let's put a little bit of chopped dill in there. And voila. Now, let me see if I can find a proper plate to put it on. I mean, this is in real time. This is fast. All right, pour a little sauce over it. All right, and how about we take some of the fresh sprig of dill and put it on as a garnish? Rockfish and a vermouth sauce. Thank you. Our final dish and the dessert is an exotic fruit salad. Although it's exotic fruit, they're flown in from all over the world, so you can usually find them in most upscale supermarkets. And what I like about exotic fruit is it sort of invokes that, you know, tropical breezes, white beaches, scantily clad chefs. That is a bit scary. We'll take that one back. All right. Today we're going to use papayas, mangoes, kiwi, I think we even have a couple of lychee there, and a passion fruit. Marinate them in a little bit of sweet wine. I'm going to take the bowl. Let's put the bowl back here first. Show you how to prep some of the fruit. We have a ripe mango, which in one Indian poet called sealed jars of heavenly honey. Just like you, dear. I mean, you know, come on, work with me. Work with me here. You know what I mean? I'm trying to give you some lines here.
Keep going. We're taking notes.
All right. We're going to score the mango. Maybe you can get it better if I do it this way. Score the mango a little bit. This is an easy way, rather than peeling it and cutting it, is to score it and then open it up. There you go. Right. Let me put it in the bowl and just cut it into the bowl or scoop it out with a fork or a spoon. I should have cut it a little deeper here because we got some chunks, but anyway, you get the idea. All right. We're going to take papaya, which we need to cut in half, peel, scrape those seeds out. And put that there. And slice this up. We're just going to dice all the fruit, really, like this. All right, get those seeds out of there. Put them in the bowl. Okay. Any questions so far on this? We have kiwi fruit. Got to have a little kiwi. Chinese gooseberry, although most of them do come from New Zealand now. Slice those up, put that here. And we're going to take some passion fruit, which has a rather evocative name, you know, passion fruit. But actually the name came from Spanish missionaries who thought that the purple and white flowers reminded them of Christ's passion. See, we do the sacred and the profane on this show. We'll take the passion fruit, and we're going to leave the seeds in because seeds are very good for you, very helpful, and it gives a little crunch to the salad. And I'm going to take a few raspberries, put them in there, and somehow we found a few lychees, fresh lychees. Just peel them, take a little pit out of them. They're right here. I'm going to put them in there also. Now, the real work begins, because we want to use a late harvest Gewürztraminer, for instance, from Alsace, a Sauternes from the Bordeaux area, or a sweet wine from the Loire, a sweet wine just to macerate the fruit in. I'm going to take the wine, no more than half a cup. And some honey right here. If you can find raw honey, unprocessed honey, that is the best one in the world. Honey is the oldest, best sweetener, but if you can find it raw, unprocessed, all those wonderful minerals or enzymes and enzymes are in there, and it just adds to that good feeling, wonderful health and nutrition, the healthiness of the meal. And just mix the wine and the honey together. And I must tell you that the raw honey costs a little bit more, but your honey's the best and she deserves the best, and just go with it. All right. Or he. Whomever you're preparing for. All right. Now, then I'm going to take, about a tablespoon and a half of finely chopped mint. And just mix it together lightly, and you have your fruit salad. Make this ahead, you know, keep it in the fridge, and just bring it out a little bit beforehand. You know, it's really simple. These don't have to be hard. You don't have to go out. You're not trying to compete with a French restaurant. Did I say anything bad about French restaurants? Aren't we in a French restaurant? You are trying to show that person how much you care about them, a little energy. It's nice to take somebody out, but a real birthday surprise is to just say, hey, I'm going to fix it for you right here. You know, you fix them something, and who knows? Who knows what might ensue? All right, let me dish this up and show you how it's presented. I have a nice little bowl here, and I'm going to take some salad and just spoon it out on the plate. Or in stemmed ware, it would certainly be nice. Or if you're really feeling frisky and had an extra papaya, you could put the fruit salad in a papaya half. Get all those wonderful additional enzymes And then I'm going to find a nice sprig of mint, which we have growing outside in the herb garden.
Jacques, could you explain how to choose a fresh mango and papaya? Is it by touch or feel?
Oh, touch and feel. color is a good indicator. The papayas, for instance, tend to be green, and they tend to yellow up when they are changed, you know, more yellow color when they're riper. And again, you press them. The mangoes, you know, there is about 400 varieties of mangoes. Some are small, some are large. Most of them you hear are of this variety, and it's the same thing. The fruit has a color rather away from the green to the yellow or the orange color or reddish color, and the flesh gives a little bit. I think that's probably the best way. Wow. Exotic fruit salad. Cook for that special someone, and they will show you their appreciation. Thank you very much. Thank you.